So I'm going to talk about full-duplex wireless, which is a physical layer technique, possible choice for fifth generation systems. And well, it's a hot topic at the moment at the physical layer. And in this talk, it has two parts. The first part is an introduction to the full-duplex research topic in general, and for this I use my previous results from full-duplex relay. And in the second part of the talk, I will discuss bidirectional full-duplex communication links. So let's start with an introduction on what is full-duplex. Let's take a definition of full-duplex from Wikipedia. That's the old definition. And a full-duplex is designating a mode of operation by which information can be transmitted in both directions simultaneously between two points. So according to old definition, we are transmitting in two directions simultaneously. We are transmitting in two directions in full-duplex mode. But this definition is very ambiguous because it doesn't define the level of abstraction. It doesn't tell us should be on the physical layer or should be on a higher layer. Let's say, based on this definition, all phone calls are full-duplex because you know that you can speak and listen to at the same time. But then actually what matters for spectral efficiency is what happens at the physical layer, at the lower abstraction layers. Also then, this definition doesn't tell us if we can cheat by allocating different channels for two directions. Based on this definition, we can have one frequency band for this direction and other frequency band for the other direction, and still it's considered to be full duplex, although we are allocating double the resources and cheating in that sense. Also, modern systems are networks. They are not links, exactly point-to-point links between two terminals. That's also a problem here. Even what is worse is that the ITU or definition from more than 20 years ago is defining that this terminology is outdated. So now the field is adopting a new terminology for full duplex. And we are switching away, scope away from point-to-point link to a operation point. So one terminal in a large network, and we define the operation mode of that terminal to be half duplex or full duplex. So then this is what I have coined myself for the new definition based on the old definition. So full duplex is designating an operation mode by which information can be transmitted to and from a point in two directions simultaneously on the same physical layer. So now we have a direct link for the spectral efficiency of the system. So we don't cheat by allocating more frequency band or something. Also, this is modern definition. It can be applied into networks because these kind of terminals you build networks by connecting terminals to each other. And okay, it's not only me who is already understanding the full duplex concept like this, but the field is adopting this definition. So now this talk is about it's a tutorial to full duplex wireless, and when we talk about full duplex wireless systems, we refer to systems that have nodes operating in the full duplex mode. Other term that is used for this is simultaneous transmit and receive, which I like very much because it has this nice abbreviation style. So, but it's not coined by me, it's coined by Dan Bliss from Arizona State University. So either star or full duplex, that's the thing what we are discussing here. And at the physical layer, it's a progressive frequency reuse concept. So by reusing the same channel for transmissions in two directions, we can ideally have double spectral efficiency, because we can transmit those two data packets simultaneously. But okay, this is not coming for free, because there's a significant technical problem. When a transceiver is transmitting and receiving at the same time, there's a huge amount of interference. The transmitted signal is leaking back to the receiver side. And also, even if we cancel if we get rid of the interference completely, the full duplex may not be that good after all, because we need to have a symmetric traffic pattern. You can imagine that if you transmit data in one direction, there's no point in allocating the other direction. So the requested rates needs to be kind of symmetric. Also, this is related to the problem of asymmetric generic quality. So even if the requested rates are the same, the achieved rates may be different, because the generic qualities are different. So now, if we think of larger networks, they can
just a question. Are you going to elaborate on the asymmetric channel later?
Yeah, a little bit. Yes. Yeah. So we can identify three basic, some people call them atomic scenarios for full duplex transceivers that build bigger networks. But in all these scenarios, the basic building block is a full duplex transceiver. So even if we use it in one of the scenarios or in larger networks, the main building block is a full duplex transceiver, a terminal that is receiving and transmitting at the same time on the same frequency. So my work at the physical layer has been mainly on using full duplex transceivers for communication purposes. But you can imagine that full duplex transceiver or star transceiver may be useful for other purposes as well. Let's say for cognitive radio, it would be really useful to have a terminal which is able to sense the spectrum at the same time it's using as a secondary user. Or some military applications, you can have a secure receiver which is sending jamming signal to an eavesdropper at the same time it's receiving the desired signal. So there's currently a lot of work on building prototypes of terminals. So you isolate the terminal from the network and try to just implement the device which is operating in the full duplex mode. I'm myself skeptical on designing a single array full duplex transceiver. So I in the figures I make the assumption that we have one array for transmitting and another array for receiving. Because if you try to connect the transmit and receive feed to the same antenna and then get isolation for that, it's kind of difficult. The main isolation would be coming from the circulator. But maybe in the future we can also have a single antenna or single array for duplex transceivers. So the results, analytical results that I have are not limited to the two array case, but I just show it in the figures. So now the basic communication scenarios for full duplex terminals are shown here. We can have a relation link. My thesis was about this relay scenario. So you forward signal from a source node through a relay. And now the relay is receiving and transmitting at the same time on the same channel. So this link is taking place at the same time as this link. Other scenario is a bidirectional link between two terminals. Both of them are operating in a full duplex. You can have also a full duplex access point which is serving half duplex users, like conventional mobile phones, and only the access point would be a full duplex terminal in this case. So now, in my opinion, the relay link is actually the prime candidate for full duplex operation. The reason is that the relay should be forwarding the same amount of information that it's being received. So there's no, you cannot have overflow or underflow in the relay. So basically data flowing in this link is the same as the data flowing in this link. there may be channel imbalance, so this channel may have better quality than that link. And especially this link is suffering self-interference from the relay, but this link is not, so most likely this is the bottleneck of the whole system, the first hop from the source to the relay. But then if we look at the other scenarios, probably the traffic in these two scenarios is not symmetric. You know that usually you want to download more than upload, so if this is a cell RAS system, most likely the downlink traffic is four times larger than the uplink.
I just have to say, I don't really understand these pictures. Like is that relay, you draw it as two boxes, but it's one entity?
Yeah, so I'm
transmitting in two directions.
This is like one terminal, but I explicitly denote that it has two. Like this is in practice, it's a one box, but it has a receive side and transmit side separately. So in the same way, this is one terminal, but it has receive and transmit array separately.
So is it that on the right side of that middle box is a transmitter and a receiver towards the destination, or is it just a transmitter to the right?
So this is a transmitter transmitting to here, leaking to here, and this is a receiver which is receiving from there.
Okay, I got
there.
It now. So, yeah.
But so this the ideal case is that we would have a single terminal here. If you want to make a good isolation, then there should be an RF cable here, much more distance between the arrays. That's the easy way to start implementing this kind of. We put the relay receive antenna on ground level and transmit antenna on a metro tunnel or something, so there's huge isolation in between.
Okay.
So in this, you're not worried about how you're going to build that cancellation of self-interference?
Okay, so my work is not about prototyping full-duplex. I'm starting from the assumption that there's a full-duplex device and it operates under self-interference.
Okay.
And when I started working on relays, there were no full-duplex prototypes at all. So they came after during the years.
So you have some model for how bad that leakage is?
Yeah, I'm.
And is it cancelable, or is it?
That's the problem. So
you're gonna tell us. So you'll tell us what your model is for what you can do with signal.
It's limited by the RF impairments or kind of imperfections. Okay, so traffic is most likely not symmetrical in these scenarios, so then that's why they are not so promising as the relay link. So okay, and today the first part of the talk is about the relay link, and the second part is about my current work on the two-way scenario. Okay, as I already mentioned, having a full-duplex terminal is not limited to the communication application, so we could also use it for cognitive radios or medium access control, like if we have a condensation-based MAC, it would be useful to sense collisions at the same time when you are actually transmitting. So it would decrease the delay in the condensation phase. So a lot of work is currently, not my work, but others' work is work. Just concentrating on implementing a full-duplex transceiver. So, okay, so this figure shows the scenario where we have a single array that is receiving and transmitting at the same time. So we're trying to prototype a device like this, disconnected from the whole system. But the bottom line is that even if you build a perfect prototype, there will be residual interference. And my work has started from the assumption that there's a residual interference. So the first part of the talk is about full-duplex relay. This is a tutorial. I'm using this application as an example for introducing the research problem. And the basis here, there's a lot of the basis here is taken into account the self-interference. There's a lot of information theoretic ideal works already, like from 20 years, 30 years back on full ideal full-duplex link, so you are able to operate in a full-duplex mode so that the interference disappears. So the new aspect, what I did, I added the self-interference link into this picture and then studied what happens, how to operate that, and how it compares with half-duplex when we have the self-interference. If we didn't have self-interference, then it would be obvious that full-duplex is better than half-duplex. There's nothing to study there. So I don't know, this is a basic introduction to relaying. Relaying node is receiving data from a source node and forwarding it to a destination. There, we can have different topologies like multiple hops or parallel relays as well. And the common protocols for relays are amplifier, forwarding, decoder, and forward. So when we do full duplex relay, this link from source to relay is operating on the same frequency as the link from relay to destination. And these kind of devices are already available, like for example in digital TV transmission. They are repeaters that are repeating on the same frequency. But now I'm considering more sophisticated, not just like analog amplification, but we can have more processing there, like similar relays as they have in cooperative communication already. So relays can be used for coverage extension. So we place a relay at the edge of a cell so that the transmission range of a base station is extended to some area where it doesn't go directly through. In cooperative communication, we use relays for diversity enhancement. So if the direct link is instantaneously weak due to fading, we can recover the signal through a relay. Now, for full-duplex relays, the more relevant application scenario is coverage extension. Just for the reason that we can get the diversity by doing simple switching. So whenever direct link is good, we only use that one, and whenever direct link is weak, we use the relay. And both of them have the same. Both of them avoid the rate loss of half duplex. Whereas in half duplex, that's more useful for diversity improvement, because whenever we choose to transmit the data through a relay, we have a like basically loss of half or 50% loss in the rate. Okay, so a little bit more on the inherent symmetry of full-duplex relay. So in half-duplex case, we need to divide the link source relay and relay destination transmission in frequency or time. So we need to have basically double the resources for compared to full-duplex. But there the challenge may be still asymmetric, so that the more data can be transmitted on this channel than this channel. Did this answer to your question on the asymmetry? So now, currently I have been working on a joint processing concepts. So what I'm presenting today is going to be more about interference removal in a full duplex relay, not doing joint optimization for the whole link. But currently I'm also working on concepts where you would do joint processing in the relay so that the source relay transmission and the self-interference signal are somehow jointly decode the useful signal and try to suppress the interference signal. Same goes for the destination node, because now this direct signal, if it exists, it's going to be overlapped with the signal from a relay. And there's a processing delay in the relay, so basically it's same information is flowing through the relay and from the direct link, but the information, the symbols are delayed when they pass through the relay. So if we don't do anything, then the direct link will be interference for the destination. So now I'm working on, and also some others are working on concepts how to combine these two transmissions when they are first received, like as a combination, and then you would separate and use the information from both transmissions. In half-duplex scenario, the direct link is no problem because you first transmit on this link, so there's a time slot when you receive the direct transmission alone, and in the second time slot or second frequency channel you receive the information from the relay, so they are not overlapping in half-duplex. Okay, so now let's go to the problems. What makes full-duplex difficult? So the main problem, or everything comes from the main problem, which is the loopback self-interference. When the relay is transmitting and receiving at the same time on the same frequency, the transmitted signal is looping back to the receiver. And this is a huge, significantly difficult problem, because this signal, what is the desired signal coming from a distant node, let's say from a base station several kilometers away, maybe 100 decibels below the interference signal, because the interference signal is traveling only a few centimeters or tens of centimeters. So then the problem is how to recover the very weak useful signal, or relatively very weak useful signal, when we have the strong interference there. This is also the reason why I believe that the full-duplex relays will be first used in an infrastructure setup, not as a cooperative communication scenario where you have mobile terminals relaying. I think it would be quite impossible to make a full-duplex mobile phone like small phone which is receiving and transmitting at the same time on the same frequency. So, but if we have an infrastructure-based setup, there's some room for isolate the transmit and receive side as like placing them on different sides of the device and pointing them at different directions. So, first thing what we need to guarantee before we can do digital signal processing is that the AD conversion is not saturated. As I said, this signal, the useful signal here can be 100 decibels above the interference signal. And AD conversion has maybe 65 or so dB of dynamic range. So the quantization noise is 65 dB below the sum signal. So now the signal power is dominated by the interference signal. So basically, the quantization noise at the AD conversion is let's say 65 dB below the interference signal. But if our desired signal is 100 decibels below the interference signal, then the desired signal is 35 dB below the quantization noise. So first thing what we need to just we need to guarantee is that the AD conversion is not saturated. So we need to do suppression before the AD conversion. I have an example on this AD conversion problem. So let's say this red curve here is the interference signal, and blue sinusoid is the desired signal. So the amplitude of the desired signal is much bigger, and then this magenta curve, which is wobbling here, is the sum signal what we actually receive. So we don't receive separately these two signals, but the wobbling signal over there. And that is what we quantize at the receiver. This example has 4-bit resolution for the AD conversion. So we quantize the sum signal, and then since we know what is transmitted, we can try to subtract away the interference signal here. So this is what is left after subtraction. So effectively, starting from 4-bit quantization, we have only 1-bit resolution for the signal of interest. In practice, the situation is much more difficult even because the interference is much more weaker. In comparison, if we have the same sinusoids, but they have the same amplitude, then we have a 3-bit resolution for the signal of interest. And now in this example, I scale variable gain amplifier before AD conversion, so which is implementing automatic gain control. So this is assuming that the dynamic range is spanning the whole signal. In the opposite scenario, we could let the signal be clipped. So then we have a higher resolution, but then some clipping events when the signal is completely lost. So there's no way to really avoid it. We get a 2-bit resolution whenever the signal is not clipped, but then it's completely lost. So that's why we need to do first mitigation in analog domain. So let's say we take the signal after a DA conversion and filter it and subtract it in analog domain. So this is a radio frequency RF signal what we want to subtract. That's an electronics design problem, really difficult one. I'm not able to answer it myself because I'm working on the digital signal processing side. But the analog processing would need to take care of, would need to be used here. Okay, and there's already works by others on implementing prototypes that do analog cancellation. But what I can do in my work is to do beamforming at the transmitter side. So properly doing beamforming at the transmitter so that when the signal goes through the channel, it already disappears on the air. So conceptually, you can think of transmitting in the null space of this leaking channel. So then we can do digital beamforming, and in the same way the interference is cancelled. And this is what I can contribute to. Okay, as I mentioned, the state of the art devices need two separate antenna arrays, one for receiving and other for transmitting. And this is a joint work with colleagues from a radio department. So they have implemented the prototype antenna arrays which have a high isolation between the antennas. The antenna array is about the size of a Wi-Fi box. So it's receiving on one side and transmitting on one side.
What frequencies?
That was 2.4 or something we can measure without any licenses. I think I don't have any photo here now. So first thing what we need to guarantee is physical isolation. So we can place the arrays far away. We can design the directivity of those arrays. And I have here some measurement results versus the distance between the arrays. So the setup was so that the receiving antenna was placed outside of a building next to a window, and then the transmitting antenna was inside a conference hall like this. So this is the receiving antenna outside, and then this is the transmitting antenna with different directions how we can point them. And then the distance between the arrays was varied to get different instances of the channel. We can also make it a compact array configuration so that we place the arrays together only like 2 centimeters apart, like compact Wi-Fi sized terminal. An interesting thing what we noticed here that by by extrapolating this curve here, where we have the configuration 4, so the arrays are pointing at different directions. So when we extrapolate this to 2 centimeter distance between these two scenarios, we get 56 dB. Whereas for the compact array configuration, we get only 36 dB. isolation.
And so all these isolation numbers get better if you go to higher frequency?
Probably, yes. At least like walls are more heavily isolating if you...
And so I don't have like a 5G system where I had my outdoor receiver and then like shove the thing through a wall.
Yeah, and
that
also
should be really good, right?
In a millimeter wave, I think you can have very directive antennas, so I think it will be easier. And if you probably this 20 dB isolation coming from the window glass is going to be higher for millimeter waves. So what I observe here is that the window glass in Finland we have a high heat insulation on windows. So then that's why the window glass is giving us 20 decibels of extra isolation for the full duplex setup. So it would be beneficial to place one array on receiver array on outside and transmit array on inside.
So basically, is there, I mean, since you mentioned window, there's working basically materials that you could try to use.
Yeah, right. That's like material science then.
Right.
So what I have myself is just the measured channels and I can do then signal processing using those as a module for my channels. So I'm not able to contribute on designing. But these guys are from the radio department, so they are actually building the antenna arrays and they have really really sophisticated ways to add some kind of wave blockers there on the edges of the terminal that the isolation becomes.
So out of curiosity, shouldn't like one and two orientation be the same?
Without any echoes they should be. If you measure this in an unechoic chamber, but this was measured in a room, so maybe if there was it was placed here, it's different than if the signal is bouncing from a wall. And
so basically, it was next to a wall or something.
Yeah, well, it was moved around the room in different places, so because we need to change the distance between the arrays. So I think they have measured this also in an unechoic chamber, and then the isolation should be quite the same. Of course, there's some calibration and this kind of manufacturing differences. It's not exactly the same.
So the P1 is the receive power?
This one here. That's the isolation between the arrays. Okay, so with this result, I just want to explain the objective for active mitigation. So I have simulated the bit error rate for decoder and forward relay with interference suppression and without interference suppression, also for half duplex. So now this is the interference level which is increasing to the right. And for half duplex, it's not affected by the interference because we are not receiving and transmitting at the same time.
It was 30 dB.
Yeah. So now the without cancellation or any mitigation, the interference starts to the error rate starts to increase when we increase the amount of interference. But then when we implement the mitigation scheme, these curves are basically shifted to the right. And the target use case for full duplex operation is over here. So we would like to suppress the interference so that the bit error rate is same in full duplex and half duplex. But then in full duplex we get double the symbol rate because we transmit and receive at the same time. So there are two basic concepts, different concepts for active mitigation in the digital domain. Since it's a single terminal, the terminal knows what is being transmitted, at least in principle. So it can measure the channel, filter the transmitted signal to match the channel, and subtract it away from the received signal. Or then we can have a filter at the receiver and transmitter side so that whatever we're transmitting is is going to different directions than the propagation path, the coupling path between the arrays. Same thing for receiver side. The cancellation is a quite straightforward task because we just main problem is to estimate the channel and then we just subtract away the signal. But then if the spatial domain suppression where we design the beamforming filter, that's a more evolved thing and we have a lot of flexibility what to do. And because we design two filters so that when they receive and transmit through some channel, then the interference would be eliminated or suppressed.
I guess it seems like if you design a beamformer, though, you have to worry about reflection paths or not. Like, so somehow, maybe you'll talk about the, are you going to talk about the spatial domain? The
okay, so this I'm doing this like in a narrowband scenario. So I have some channel matrix for this channel, and I'm considering the reflections, and I'm implicitly assuming OFDM.
He has a way of measuring the current, which doesn't change much because it's sort of stationary situation.
But in essence, though, when you show this picture of the signal looping around, right?
Yeah.
That's somehow a proxy for some non-line of sight path. Like there would be the I mean, I'm kind of, you know.
Related to these results, I have the measured channels for the example setup.
Okay.
And
so somehow, if you do that measurement inside a room, you get a different answer than if you do that measurement out in an open field.
Yeah, for sure. It's not like that. You would calibrate the array only once, and then continue using it. But you would need to basically track this channel on the run, during operation, and then redesign the filters. Also for beamforming, you would need to all the time control the filters given the channel response. Maybe only the strongest leaking components that are directly coupling between the arrays, like currents flowing around the device. Maybe those are kind of static, but then if the environment changes, then the channel changes for sure. Okay, but still suppression is not so straightforward even, or also these are limiting cancellation as well. So because we already discussed that at the receiver side we have the AD conversion, which is a problem. We estimate the channel, so there's most likely an estimation error. We don't know the channel exactly, so when we try to cancel it, the estimation error will cause some residual interference. And since we are now aiming at like close to 100 decibels of isolation, the estimation error needs to be also at the same level, so like really small. So even small estimation error is going to cause us residual interference. But still I think that the channel estimation is not the main problem, but the transmitter imperfections. So we ideally know the digital signal what we want to transmit, but then transceivers are imperfect. They are usually measured using EVM in conformance testing. That whatever is transmitted is actually distorted. And power amplifier is one significant source of distortion. So we don't know exactly what is being transmitted. We only know approximately. This can be modeled as a noise factor coming from the distortion to the signal. So now if we take this signal and try to subtract it away, it doesn't help anything because here we have noise which is not subtracted, it's leaking back through the channel. And now EVM values can be like minus 35 dB or so. So it meaning that the noise introduced here is 35 dB below the interference signal. So also over here, if the desired signal is 100 decibels below the interference signal, then the desired signal is 65 dB below the EVM, what is introduced at this side. Okay, so so okay, so still mentioned that this problem can be handled with beamforming. So if we do beamforming at the receiver side, we can block everything what is being transmitted without knowing the signal. So even if we introduce a lot of noise here, if we can know the channel well enough, we can design the receiving filters that the signal is blocked. But same cannot be done with digital domain cancellation. So now I have some simulation results for different types of suppression, like antenna selection and beam selection and null space projection, which could be used for suppressing the interference. Sometimes it's also beneficial to combine cancellation and spatial domain suppression. I think there's no time to go through these in detail, but I'll just point out some main conclusions obtained from these. So we can see that the antenna selection is giving us very low extra isolation. By the way, these are like CDF of the extra isolation we get from the. So this is the isolation amount and this is the probability quantile of that isolation. So for example, over here we get 90% of the cases are the isolation is below 9 dB or so. So anyway, so antenna selection gives us very very low extra isolation, and that's why there's no point in considering that for interference removal. Then we can do beam selection. We form eigenbeams and then do similar type of selection there. Then we get much better extra isolation. If we have enough degrees of freedom, we can use null space projection. Then we actually receive and transmit in orthogonal directions, but interference is completely eliminated, except for the residual interference coming from the imperfections. What could be a useful thing to exploit is the rank of the loop channel. So if the arrays are placed very close to each other, and there's line of sight, it may be possible that the rank is limited between those arrays. And that can be very useful for spatial domain suppression. But for cancellation, the rank doesn't have much effect, or actually any effect. Only the channel estimation may be easier for rank limited channel. This shows the effect of.
Can you elaborate on that a little bit more? Like, is it good to have low rank?
Yeah.
Means so, that you don't want to have too much dispersion in the channel.
So if this channel has a low rank.
Yeah.
Conversely, it has high large null space.
Right. So you can use the.
You have more flexibility to design transmit filter and receive filter into null space. If this is a full rank, then the null space is smaller.
Yeah, sure.
Square case, there's no null space, but usually you need to assume like non-square case. That you have more antennas on one side, so then you have a null space for the channel.
But if you use pre-coding, it's supposed to increase the null space.
Well, this is like I'm doing the optimization given the amount of spatial streams you want to transmit. So that's like a constraint that we have two streams on the receive side and two streams on the transmit side. So if you do pre-coding and if you transmit only one stream, then you have more flexibility that increases the null space. So I'm like, given the constraints, I try to maximize the number of spatial streams of what can be transmitted. Okay, so then this shows the effect of of the, that imperfect site information or the hardware impairments. So this is the distortion caused by the transmitter, and here we have the relative error in general estimate, and this is the extra isolation what we get from the y-axis is the extra isolation what we get from cancellation or suppression. So as expected, the extra isolation drops when we have a higher estimation error or more distortion at the transmitter. But as I already implied, the receive side beamforming solution can be made immune to transmit side noise. So here we can see a scenario where we add more and more noise. Actually, here we have 10 times more noise than the useful signal at the extreme case. But the receive side beamforming, because it's only adapted to the channel, not the signal itself, so it's removing everything what is receive side beamforming here. In suitable conditions can remove everything what is coming from the channel, be it the noise or useful signal. Okay, so but we need to conclude that the interference cannot be removed completely. And in a relay link, the channel asymmetry actually gives us still a second way to make the system better, even with residual interference. And that is power control. So this link from source to relay is usually the bottleneck of the system because of the self-interference. And if we try to cancel the interference, there will be residual, but still after that we can use power control. If we lower the relay transmit power, we make this second link effectively weaker than before, but in return we can improve the first hop. And the optimal case we have a balanced hops under the self interference. So this is like a win-win solution that we save energy if you save energy by reducing transmit power at the same time as the performance is increased. So this is an example of what happens for the SINR in an amplifier and forward relay link versus the relay gain. Okay. So we can see that the end-to-end SNR in the relay link is increasing up to some point, and then it starts to decrease because then the first hop becomes the bottleneck, and the self-interference in the link is preventing the or being the bottleneck of the whole system. Okay, only if we can cancel very efficiently the self-interference, then we should use the maximum transmit power in the system. So then given the fact that we have residual interference, I have made comparison between half-duplex and full-duplex relay. And these are really principles, just not information theory as such, what I now discuss here. So in half-duplex link, we have a loss factor as a prelog factor in a rate expression. So if we express the rate like this, whereas in a full-duplex link, we don't have the loss factor, but then the signal-to-interference and noise ratio is decreased because of the residual self-interference. And now there's a trade-off to choose if we do this or this. Also, this is connected to power control, so we can do same comparison with power control. Okay, so this shows how the rate of full duplex is decreasing when we increase the self-interference power. But what I want to hear, I want to reflect back to the fact that I said that the use case for full duplex is the coverage extension, not diversity enhancement. And from here we can see switching boundaries. So this is x-axis is the SNR of the first hop, and y-axis is the SNR of the second hop. And now if we are below these switching boundaries, for different protocols, we should use direct transmission only. It gives better rate than full duplex or half duplex. If you are above the boundaries, then relaying gives better rate than direct transmission. And now, even rather weak, let's say minus 1 dB SNR for the direct link, then we should already choose direct transmission. Because in half duplex, we have the rate loss, and in full duplex, we already gain the diversity benefit by doing switching between the links.
I have to admit, I don't understand that figure. So somehow, so this is the x-axis is the
source to relay SNR.
And this is
the relay to destination SNR. And these are the switching boundaries, like decision regions. So.
And what the switching boundaries are parameterized by something?
They are parametrized. So basically, this works so that you decide what is your SNR in both links. You pick a point, and then you look at which side of boundary you are. So if you are on this side of the boundary, you should do direct transmission because it gives you better rate.
But what makes the boundary move? Like yourself, their parameter.
Source to distance.
So I increase here the source to
destination.
So
the destination is
direct link SNR.
So when the direct link SNR becomes large, we should the area for direct transmission is becoming larger and larger. So we should always use, even for rather weak direct link SNR, we should use direct transmission. This shows that the direct link is not so useful for diversity benefit in full duplex relay. I have now then similar boundaries between half and full duplex. One without transmit power adaptation and other with transmit power adaptation. So given the first hop SNR and the second hop SNR, we can choose which mode is giving us better rate.
The simulations are like...
These are not simulations, these are coming from analytical expressions that I have derived for the system.
But what is the model is like? There's no fading, there's no...
This is for static channels, so what I was about to next discuss is that in a fading scenario, we are jumping all the time... technically, it's jumping all the time between the boundaries. And that's why I concluded here that actually, we should do hybrid full duplex relay. So we should, during transmission, for some channel state, we should do half duplex, and for some channel state, we should do full duplex, so that we choose the mode of opportunistically.
So there's dotted lines also. What are the dotted lines?
So one is amplifier forward type of relay, and other is decoder forward type of relay.
So is that this amplifier forward?
Yeah, it's the same boundaries, but for different protocols.
Can you give an intuition about the full duplex? You should use full duplex for higher SNRs?
Okay, so when the first hop SNR is large, in general you use full duplex. Because the self-interference is limiting the performance. If we have self-interference and weak source relay link, then the SINR will be really low because the SNR and SIR are both low. So now if you do transmit power adaptation, the areas, especially when the second hop is good, then areas over there are extending. And this is the fact that when the second hop is very good, we can lower the transmit power so that we improve the first hop.
So this LI, what is gamma LI?
That's the loop interference. That's the self interference level. Yeah. As an SNR, so the interference signal after mitigation versus the noise.
So these expressions, you don't have these expressions.
No, I'm not showing any expressions. They are on the paper, which is presenting these results. So I have similar cases with fading boundaries between choosing half and full duplex. Then not, we have a similar type of boundaries, but then they are more smooth because the fading averages out the effect. So now I have chosen here quite low self-interference value, so for half duplex is preferred only in a small corner area here.
So when you use the half duplex relay for different SNRs, do you change, is it half, like the time slots is like half the time the...
Oh yeah, so that's one thing what you can do in half duplex. You can optimize the time slots, but I'm assuming like half, same time slot duration for the half duplex.
So you're not optimizing it?
No. So this is, it can be done.
So when you adapt the power, you adapt fixed or you do based on the fade?
So in the context of this plot, I would be doing it for every fading state.
Uh-huh.
But then since it's impossible to compute the averages, the mean values of those rate expressions. So I assume here that the rate, in this plot here, the transmit power is done in the long term, so it's done based on the average SNRs, not for every failing state. But still we get a lot of benefit not by not doing it opportunistically. So if you I think the region for full duplex would be even increasing if we did it for every failing state. Okay, we could numerically calculate, but this we could numerically solve the integrals, but I think it's very time consuming. This is like a contour plot, so like grid of several hundred values, and then calculate the contour from that.
So what are the percentages there? What percentages have you shown there? 50%, 75%, 25%, all this. What is the percentage,
you know? This is like the rate of how much full duplex is, or how much half duplex is achieving compared to full duplex. So this is like the percentage gain, or what is get from full, what can be get from full duplex. Mm-hmm. So at maximum we would get 100 decibels gain at some point from full duplex.
And what is C?
That's the transmission rate. So at this boundary, the two half duplex and full duplex transmission rates are equal. And on this side of the boundary, the rate of full duplex is larger. And this gives this percentage gives how many percent larger it is.
Can you remind me how this transmit power adaptation is done? What are you doing for? With and without transmit power adaptation, right? So, what is the transmit power adaptation you're doing?
It's like a pack of factors. So, and the first hopper is the bottleneck. I reduce the transmit power at the relay. So then I improve the first hop and make a second hopper.
So you have some feedback. How are you doing this?
This is like a theoretical rate expression, so when you implement it in practice, you would need to know the second hop of state information. So I'm not talking about how to implement it. So everything is known, all the link SNRs,
okay.
And then I see what could be done in a most optimal case.
Okay.
Yeah, in practice, you need CSI from the destination. Okay, I have already used all the time, and the second half of the talk is remaining.
Not so
time. Should I stop here or?
I think people can leave.
Okay, so the second part of the talk is about bidirectional communication. So this is what I'm working at the moment.
You might not get the lunch though.
Yeah, so.
It's not a joke.
in bidirectional scenario, as I implied, the problem is that the traffic is asymmetric. And there's a lot of work on computing some rates for this scenario, but I don't see much. It's not so relevant because if you optimize some rate for this system, there's no control over rates in the directions. So what we should look at is the rate region of this system. So what is the transmission rate if we have a constraint for one transmit rate? What is the transmission rate in the other direction, given that constraint? And as a byproduct of this analysis, we would get also a decorrent forward relay link at the diagonal of the rate region, because it's, the rate is limited by the minimum of two rates. And now this analysis will be done at the large system limit. But we are not doing massive MIMO in a sense. So we have asymptotic results, but we try to use them for a finite size, more practical system as an approximation. Okay, and we use a replica, the replica method. I'm not the author of that, why I'm collaborating with another postdoc who is providing the analytical framework for this, and I'm providing the practical framework. But okay, I'm not going to show the replica results here at all. I'm going to show only the end results. So now in bidirectional link, we have the same problem that there's a distortion at the transmitter. So when the full-duplex terminal is receiving and transmitting at the same time, the interference signal, there will be noise in the transmitted signal, which is leaking back to the receiver. Already, all the conventional studies are basically, if you have in a conventional half-duplex study, you neglect the noise what is going in the feed-forward direction, because anyway at the receiver, it will be below the receiver noise. But we cannot neglect it in the full-duplex scenario, because the gain of this channel is huge. So then the transmitter side noise, which is leaking back from transmitter to receiver, may be above the useful signal. And now what we are doing here is we are doing, assuming that we take the decoding and the decoder and encoder of the shell. So we use standard components for the decoder and encoder, like something what you would you use for half duplex. And then we add a front end for interference mitigation. So the idea is that the front end is taking care of the full duplex specific interference issue, so that then conventional encoders can operate as they operate before, because the interference has been suppressed enough. But the problem here, if we do like this, is that the receiver will be mismatched. So a conventional receiver is not expecting to see this extra noise source there, which may be changing, and it's correlated to the channel. So then under this setup, we compare suppression and cancellation, these two different ways to eliminate the self-interference. They both can ideally eliminate it completely, but in suppression, we consume spatial decrease of freedom, so we reduce the number of spatial streams that can be transmitted and received when we do suppression. But then, on the other hand, suppression can be used for eliminating the noise. So same thing goes here as did for the relay link. So if we do beamforming at the receiver side, we can eliminate whatever is being transmitted, because it goes through the same channel. We don't need to know the signal. And also conversely, if we do transmit side beamforming, we can help the AD conversion problem, because the interference is eliminated on the air before it appears at the receiver. But then in cancellation, we are doing digital domain operation, so whatever is happening, distortion at the transmitter is there, and AD conversion problem is there. So No, I'm skipping the analysis part, so I'm going directly to the numerical results. So this is really, really, really difficult. I'm not able to understand it myself how the replica analysis works. But I believe it's correct, because we have done simulations and it matches very well. But this shows conventional rate versus SNR plots for the full duplex scenario. And now the lines are obtained from the analytical results, and then we simulate the same case using the Monte Carlo method, and the match is perfect. Maybe over here you have the largest deviation between the analytical result and the simulation results. So although the analytical result corresponds to infinite amount of antennas, if we simulate 4x8 system, then we get this match between the results. So this gives us the excuse that we can use the asymptotic results as an approximation for the finite-sized systems. So now these plots are showing two different cases when we have more receiver antennas on the left and more transmit antennas versus the other on the right. And when we do suppression with more receive antennas, then we only reduce the array gain. So that's it's not going to give us so bad effect. Only the curve is shifting. But then if we do transmit side suppression, then we lose the multiplexing order of the system. And then you can see that the angle of this rate here is different than the angle with cancellation.
So is your B notation correct? M and M? M is 4 and is 6?
Okay. Let me think.
I don't know if your A and B correspond to A and B. Or
okay, that's true. Maybe they are swapped.
They're swapped, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I think so. This would be that's an error maybe. So here we have the rate is half, and here it's. Okay, I wonder what's going on here. Okay, never mind. So probably this is supposed to show the case when we have more transmit antennas than receive antennas. So this
three half.
Yeah. The good point in doing replica analysis. So these plots here are shown for Gaussian signals. So we assume Gaussian code books. But simulating or analyzing rates in a normal setup would be really difficult if we assume a practical discrete modulation. And this shows on the analytical results we didn't yet simulate the corresponding curves because it's really very time consuming, like takes a week to simulate all these curves accurately. But we believe that they are correct, at least they make sense that they saturate to the modulation order of these schemes used.
So when you mentioned replica a few times, but I couldn't really understand what you mean by that.
Replica is this kind of mathematical tool that they use in statistical physics. They are doing it for quantum states or something. Some guys have taken that to communication theory problems, and then
it's used for your analysis, or like
yeah. So then you can analyze the transmission rate in a closed form. You can express the transmission rate in a closed form. You can do it using conventional methods for Gaussian signaling, but then if you have a like QPS scale, if you want to analyze 16 QAM or 64 QAM or something, then it's not possible exactly. So this is a tool, but and I'm not the author of the replica analysis, so it's my colleague who is providing.
I'm just trying to figure out what it
yeah.
does.
It's really difficult to understand. And also the problem there is that those guys who are using replica for communication theory problems, they are using the same notation as statistical physics guys, which is totally different from the notation what we use in communication theory. And then when I write a paper with him, I try to make the notation similar to what we use in communication theory.
Right.
But still, there's a problem because I don't fully understand what is done.
Can you use Google Translate?
Yeah, I wish I could. Okay, but anyway, so now using the replica, we can calculate analytical rates for practical digital modulation. But then the only thing is that then we are doing it asymptotically, so we cannot do it the finite size systems. But as we saw from the previous result, these are accurate as approximations for the finite sized systems. I hope that when we do the simulations, they will match with these ones. So then more contour plots where I compare suppression and cancellation. When we have a matched ideal receiver which is able to know that there's extra self-interference, then cancellation is pretty much, I mean, it's always better than suppression. So this is not so interesting case. More interesting case is that if the receiver is mismatched, so we use conventional encoder and decoder at the terminal and at the front end for interference cancellation, then there's a clear trade-off between a case when we prefer cancellation or when we prefer suppression. And okay, these are like the percentage values, how much better rate one is given over the other. And this is the x-axis is the SNR of the link and the feed-forward SNR, and the y-axis is the feedback SNR, the interference level. So now we can vary the antenna ratio between the transmit side and receive side, and so basically what is shown here, this one boundary and also this one boundary here is appearing on these plots, but then we replicate it for different antenna ratios. And now we can make choice between cancellation and suppression for different antenna ratios if we know the SNR of the system and the interference level of the system. This kind of thing would be impossible to simulate for digital modulation. This is only possible with the replica.
But did you at the end of the day like simulate or summarize your results for an engineer, what to do what? Like rule of thumb kind of things? As a suggestion?
Yeah, I have some rule of thumbs related to the relay link. So this is still working on progress. So I'm not yet, it's not fully like defined yet. But for the relay link, there's clear rule of thumbs. So for example, we can find the limiting cases, because you know that this, when you increase SNR in this direction, it becomes a straight line. So if we are basically on this side, on that SNR value, we should use full-duplex always. And this is a clear, simple expression. So you are given the loop interference level, and then from that you can directly say that if the first hop of SNR is above this one constant, then you should always use full-duplex, irrespective of the second hop SNR, because the full-duplex is always better after this point over here. A similar kind of really explicit rule of thumb I have for the relay link. So, but currently this is more like a lookup table. So if your engineer can decide what is the SNR of the system and what is the interference system, then it can point out, go to some point here, and then decide if your antenna ratio is suitable for cancellation or suppression.
Right, and then when he implements it, he realizes that the imperfections mess it up totally.
Yeah, then the estimate of the interference was wrong. So probably he would need to move to this direction over here.
There's always some margin you add.
Yeah. Okay, so then I have also calculated rate regions for as I mentioned in the very beginning. So in suppression, we have flexibility to control the number of streams that we use for transmission and reception. So with different stream configuration, we get a rectangular rate region. So by freely controlling optimally the rates, we get the convex hull of those different rate regions for the whole region of suppression. Now this cancellation case shows here the ideal case with the matched receiver for reference. I don't show the mismatched cancellation now in this plot because it's coming from a different favor here. I didn't consider the cancellation for reference. This shows only the ideal full duplex case for reference. And now here the same thing goes that I have simulated the results for a finite system, and then I also used the asymptotic result to plot this one, and here you get the biggest gap between the analytical and simulation results. So now when we increase the SNR, the rate regions increase, the shape doesn't change much. But then if we change the antenna ratio of the system, then the shape is changing quite much. I think I may need to work on how to interpret this plot more, but these are general observations from these.
Can you compensate the imbalance? I mean, if you do measurements?
Well, you can
make it part of the channel.
You can compensate it by doing scheduling, so you choose users that are balanced, for example. If you have the space station set up, and you choose one user for downlink and one user for uplink, so that they have balanced channels. But you cannot, I don't think you can control the traffic ratio, so if the users are by default expecting to have more downlink traffic than uplink traffic, there's no way to invent more uplink traffic in the system. Okay, so that's all what I had.